Hi everyone, my name is Corey Hart. I'm an education specialist with Vermont Fish and Wildlife Department, and this is part three in a four-part series called Scat and Tracks. Already we've covered deer and bobcat. Today we're going to be focusing on snowshoe hare. Snowshoe hare are not a rabbit. A lot of people mistakenly refer to them as a rabbit. We have a lot of cottontail rabbits in Vermont, but snowshoe hare is a completely separate species. And they're separate because of a couple different reasons. There's a lot of characteristics about them that are not the same as rabbits. One of the main ones is how they're born. Cottontail rabbits will actually, they give birth underground. And when they're born, those rabbits are naked. They have no fur on them and they're blind. Snowshoe hares don't give birth underground. Instead, when they give birth to fully furred snowshoe hares. In there, they can see. They're awake. They're not blind. The other big difference is their winter adaptations. Whereas the area we're in now in Vermont is not really great for cottontail rabbits, but it's amazing for snowshoe hare. It's the perfect climate for them. One of their major adaptations that they have that make it so they can actually thrive in Vermont's climate is during the summer, they're brown. And they blend in perfectly. If they're in the woods out in this area behind me during the summertime, I wouldn't see it. It blend right in. During the winter, their fur changes and they turn white. So now, if it's out behind me, I still won't see it. It's gonna blend right into the snow. And that's an amazing adaptation that snowshoe hare have. However, if it's a winter where we don't have snow, the exact opposite can happen. So now, if there's no snow on the ground and I have a snowshoe hare behind me, it's gonna stand out like a sore thumb. It'll be the only thing you can see because it just won't look right. It'll be a white rabbit against a brown backdrop. But in most normal years, what happens is we get the snow and they blend right in. By the time we lose the snow, their fur changes again, they turn brown, and they blend right back in again. Now, they'll talk a little bit about the habitat that I can find the snowshoe hare in. They like areas that are really thick, areas that they can escape, they can hide in. They especially thrive in areas like cedar swamps, evergreen swamps, basically areas like what's right behind me right now is very, very thick. It's an area where they can get plenty of food, but they can easily escape predators. It offers them plenty of safety. You won't find a snowshoe hare in an area that's really open, because why would it be there? It's not safe. It's not a safe area for it. So if I was going to go looking for snowshoe hare, they can be found across Vermont, but they're more abundant in more towards northern Vermont. We have a lot more snow. That's typically going to be where I find most of my snowshoe hare. Not to say you can't find them all across the entire state, which you can, but they're more abundant towards northern Vermont. But I also want to be focused on that habitat. Remember, again, we want to be focusing on areas where they're going to be. So in those swampy areas, that's where they love to be. With snowshoe hare, they actually don't travel very far. They only have about a 20-acre home range, which means everything they need has to be fairly close because they're going to travel very far. Whereas some species we've already discussed travel long distances, snowshoe hare aren't going to do that. Parts of their diet consists of things like, and it's seasonal, so it might change throughout the year, but especially during the summer, you're gonna find them eating things like a lot of clover, grasses, things like that. Then they're gonna eat a lot of twigs, and you also see them eating bark. And what they actually will do is you'll find areas on like small saplings and things where it's all chewed up right on the bottom. And there'll be whole areas where it's not up high like it would be with a deer, but it'd be down low where it's all been chewed up. That would be snowshoe hare. One other thing that they eat that a lot of people don't realize that's actually really neat is snowshoe hare actually have a fondness for meat. So they don't strictly eat plants and things like that. They will eat things like decaying animals. So if there was an animal that had died or something like that, snowshoe hare actually have a fondness for it and they will eat that. They'll eat a decaying animal or things like that. They're not exclusively eating things like clover and plants and things like that. A couple things about snowshoe hare that makes them really neat is actually their really big rear feet. So this is actually a rear foot from a snowshoe hare. And it's a lot wider and larger than if it came off of a cottontail rabbit. And it's actually in its name, so snowshoe. It acts like a snowshoe as it's going across the snow, and it actually keeps that snowshoe hare up and off the ground, or from sinking into the snow, I mean. It's very, very neat. Another aspect to it is not only can snowshoe hare jump really high and really far, they're actually excellent swimmers. So if we were near a body of water right now, and let's say snowshoe hare was getting chased, or something was going after it, and it wanted to escape, commonly what they actually would do is they'll get in the water and they'll swim, because they're really, really strong swimmers. And that's partially because of their really big rear feet. It acts like a kicker, or like flippers, as it's going through the water. And they'll get in the water and they'll escape that way. Instead of just running on land, they'll go through the water. And that's kind of one of those fun facts out there that people don't realize. But speaking of their feet, a lot of, especially if you're in southern Vermont, you might find a lot of rabbit tracks when I'm out there and I'm looking. The way I'm going to deviate between a rabbit track and a snowshoe hare track is by the size of it. Because, again, this is a really big foot. If I had a cottontail rabbit, it'd be a lot smaller. It'd be a lot narrower. You wouldn't have all this extra stuff to it. So that's really what I'm looking at. They're hoppers, so they're classified as a hopper, which means when I'm looking at the track, you're going to see those really big rear feet, and then the smaller front feet or paws. But with the cottontails, they're going to be a lot smaller, so the tracks are going to be a lot narrower. With a cottontail, it's going to be a really big, defined track. And that's going to be how I deviate between if I'm looking at a cottontail rabbit or am I looking at a snowshoe hare track. And you're really simply just looking at the size of it. And again, using a track ID card book is going to be an easy way for you to go about it, because it shows right on there the estimated size that you should be looking at for those type of tracks. So in addition to the tracks, when I'm out there looking for snowshoe hare, not only am I looking for those tracks, I might be finding spots or browse. So as I mentioned before, where they've been eating at kind of the edges of saplings and things like that, and it'd be right down low. But as with every species, I'd also be looking for scat. And scat actually looks fairly similar to deer scat. It's going to be a little bit smaller, and oftentimes it's black colored. So it'll be in black coloration. It's not quite as big as deer scat. Typically, I think of snowshoe hare scat kind of about the size of an M&M. Maybe a little bit larger, but not quite the size of deer. But still kind of has that round shape to it. But those are the three things I'm looking for. So looking kind of for signs of browse, I'm looking for tracks, and I'm looking for scat. And remember, the most important thing when I'm out there looking is you have to be in the right habitat. If I'm in the wrong habitat, you might have a wonderful hike in the woods, you could have a lot of fun, but you're not gonna find the species you're looking for. You might, you never know. There's always a chance. But your chances are greatly increased if you go to the right area. So for snowshoe hare, if I go to a swampy area, your chances of finding them go up a lot, because it's an area where they can escape predators and they feel safe. What I'd like to do now is the same thing we've done on every single episode of these, is I want you to go out there with your parent or guardian or teacher and try to find sign of that snowshoe hare. And while you're out there looking, don't forget, we've also been looking for deer and bobcat. So just because we're looking for snowshoe hare now doesn't mean we should stop looking for those other species. Same with other tracks as well. It's great to learn as you go. So if I bring my track ID cards out there with me and I find some other tracks, or I find some other scat I don't know, always take a photo of it, sketch it, look it up, and find out what that is. That's one of the easiest ways to learn, is just kind of as you're doing it. And next week we're going to be focused, or on our next episode, our last and final one is going to be focused on raccoon.